I was watching a clip of you on Rogan, and you were talking about, or Rogan was saying that you shouldn't be high all the time. And then you said, yeah, it's important to find your balance, go back to the center, find your baseline, I think that was your phrase, and do a reality check, that some people fail to do a reality check. Can you expand on that?
Well, yeah, I think, I mean, for one thing, through psychedelics, you can't really be high on them all the time, you know, in the sense that they induce tolerance very quickly. You know, if you take LSD or psilocybin or any of these every day for a few days on the, you know, you're going to get a much diminished effect unless you increase the dose substantially. So there is that. They kind of have their built-in, you know, safeguard against misuse. And, you know, they're not addictive, right? I mean, these things are not addictive. They're anti-addictive in a certain sense. Most people have to, you know, kind of screw their courage up to go back and take them. But I also think that in the state itself, they can tell you a lot of things. You know, you can get a lot of supposed insights and so on. But they can be delusions. You know, I mean, in some ways, they encourage, well, they stimulate funny ideas, you know. And that's part of the fun. That's part of the reason we take them, is because we like funny ideas. We like, you know, to look into unexplored parts of our consciousness. But you should always keep your skeptical antennas well deployed and well tuned for these experiences. And if some revelation comes out of the experience, you know, it may be true and it may not be true. Give yourself 48 hours in a sober state to reflect on it. From that perspective, does it really hold up, or was this just some wild idea? You know, I mean, I mean, Terrence and me are kind of textbook cases for people that didn't do that, you know, back in the day, and we got down the rabbit hole of, you know, some pretty wild ideas that in the end were not valid, you know?
That's extremely interesting. Was that an attitudinal difference between you and your brother? Do you feel like you were more on the side that said, okay, let's get some insight and let's give it 2 days to 7 days? I think 2 days is quite short, actually, but let's say
two
whatever.
Days, yeah. Well, yes and no. I mean, if you read our book, you know, we did this together. I was the one that was, you know, sort of lost in a realm of delusion, you know. But I recovered. Terrence was lost in a realm of delusion. In some ways, he didn't recover in the sense that he stuck with these ideas and developed a career based on these ideas. And in some ways, you know, there was much of his suppositions about the mushrooms, about the whole thing, that was just not true in the end, you know. And I was, because I went further at the beginning, I was more cautious. I was, after the experiment, after whatever happened to us, I was happy to be able to, you know, get my feet back on the ground. And I mean, I didn't give up my interest in psychedelics, and I didn't stop taking psychedelics, but I was more cautious after that. Mm. And, you know, I think we just have to be careful. I mean, I get emails occasionally, you know, from people that are, you know, thoroughly lost, sort of in webs of delusion, that they've had experiences with psychedelics and certain, you know, like cognitive or you know, certain understandings or cognitive frameworks, whatever you want to call it, have been revelations, you know, revelations, in supposed insights. And, you know, and they have not reflected on it. You know, does this really make sense? And there's a tendency for, you know, you have to keep your analytical faculties intact. You have to be able to step away from the experience and look at it more objectively, in the same way that psychedelics, one of the things they facilitate is, you know, one of the basis of their therapeutic usefulness is they let you step away from ordinary consciousness and examine your usual so-called default mode network framework. Psychedelics temporarily disable that. That can be very useful, but it's going to reassert itself, you know, because let's face it, ordinary consciousness, whatever we mean by that, that's where we are most of the time, you know, and so we need to be able to function, and we need to be able to, you know, sort of evaluate these revelations, these insights, in terms of, you know, in terms of kind of consensus reality, you know. Do they conform with it? Because if you don't, then it, you know, if you get lost in delusion, you're into, you know, you're off into places that psychiatrists might say is effectively a delusional ideation, you know, like I am the Messiah and I'm here to, you know, save the world, that sort of thing. Psychedelic make you convince you that in fact you are. I could tell you from experience, no, you're not the Messiah. You're not going to save the world.
You know? So the counterpoint would be like, well, look, society can be sick. And then there's a phrase like, there's nothing healthy about being sane in a sick society, something like that. I don't buy that. I used to, but I've had my own experiences that I could tell you about some other time. Terrifying, terrifying. I could say that with a small smirk, mainly because of nervousness, but also because I've had some distance from the experience. But like truly, truly terrifying experiences.
Yeah.
I don't subscribe to that, though I used to, because I was the type of person that's like, hey, you innovate. That's the whole point of, is you generate new ideas. It may not conform, but it's new. Yeah, but also sometimes you can generate false ideas. And it's so super easy to deceive oneself. And it feels like you've received truths that are so true. It's remarkable. Anyhow, this is something that isn't talked about much. What I want to know is, how is it that you recognize that you're on a deceptive path? So you had to, number one, recognize that, which isn't easy because almost by definition, you don't think you're on one. So how did you recognize that? And then what did you do to pull yourself back out of it? And you said something interesting, which is like, put my feet back on the ground. You said something like that. It does feel like you're just in this wispy place where you're not centered. You're swimming in a, I'd like to say it's like you're swimming in this whirlpool. There's a quote by Rene Descartes that said, it feels like I'm swimming interminably in a whirlpool such that I can't touch the ground nor swim to the top.
Exactly. So you have to give yourself a chance to get your center again after the experience, you know, without any other substances. Give yourself the 48 hours, 72 hours, whatever it is, you know, to find your center. You could also ask, you know, if you have people around you that know, you know, that you respect, you can also kind of bounce it off them as well and say, well, I'm having this revelation or these insights, but does that really jive with what you understand how reality is? I mean, it's interesting, you know, after we did the experiment at La Chirera and we were still more or less caught in this delusional space, you know, a couple months after, you know, I mean, Terrence was completely convinced that whatever we said we'd done at La Truera, we'd succeeded. You know, we weren't, it didn't necessarily happen on schedule, but he was convinced, and he actually came back from South America to California and went to visit his friends and more or less announced, you know, that we have done this thing.
Sorry, what is it that he was convinced of? He was convinced that you had done something?
Yeah, that we had succeeded, that the experiment had succeeded.
The experiment of?
At La Churera, we had created this self-transforming fusion of mind and matter and all that. The point is that he went back and talked to his friends who hadn't had this experience and more or less announced that, you know, we've done it and history's going to end any day now. They were like, what? Wait a minute. You know, you're seriously divorced from reality. And as it turns out, they were right. You know, so it's good to, and the thing is, Terence always said, and I think it's true, they make you have funny ideas. You know, they make you have interesting ideas. They give you that facility. But those ideas are sometimes valid, sometimes very interesting. Most of them are probably just delusional. But, you know, you have to look at them from an objective point of view before you can really dismiss them or accept them.
Uh-huh. That's interesting. So an analogy I'm making in my head right now is LLMs, like ChatGPT. They confabulate. What they'll create is quite creative.
Yes.
But then sometimes they'll make up a fact confidently, and they don't know that they're making up that fact. So they need a way of testing with reality. And that's coming. Like, there are multimodal LLMs.
It is very similar to that. I haven't used ChatGPT, but I've read about it, and ChatGPT is very similar. It'll come up with this stuff that seems to be so convincing and logical, and it makes sense and all that. But if you look beneath the surface a little bit, it's like it's smoke and mirrors. There's nothing there.
You can ask it, who is Dennis McKenna? And it'll say, he is the brother of Terence McKenna, an astronaut from the 1950s. It'll say it so assertively that you're like, oh, great, this is absolutely correct.
Yeah.
You know, in some sense, you're a psychonaut, so partially correct.
That's exactly right. So, yeah, we have to be, I mean, ultimately, you know, Curt, we have to trust ourselves, you know. You're the final judge, you know, of whether these things make sense or not, you know. But that said, you can certainly test it. You know, science, as an example, comes up with theories and hypotheses, models of phenomena, and so on that you test by asking questions of nature in a very systematic way that can be tested. The hypothesis, you know, you create a model of a process or something. And then you don't try to prove the theory, you try to disprove the theory. That's what sets science apart from, say, religion or dogma or other types of doctrine. You know, everything is provisional. You come up with an idea, say, okay, does this fit with the data? And what part of the data does it not explain? You know, and that's the scientific process. And you can use that same process pretty much in your own thinking about these ideas that you may come up with from psychedelic experiences. You know, and then science also, you know, another thing about science is it's imperfect and it's flawed, but there's also a community of like-minded people. You know, there's the peer review.
That's interesting.
You know, the peer review process, as flawed as it is useful, because you come up with your hypothesis and you put it out there, you describe it as closely as you can. But you may have overlooked things. So you publish a paper or you get reviewers and they come back and they say, well, you know, here's the problem or here's what it doesn't explain. That is useful. So then you can either, you know, you can just throw the idea out completely if it's seriously flawed, or you could say, well, wait a minute, we have to back up and tweak it a little bit and change some premises of the hypothesis. And, you know, thank you for identifying the gaps in our ideas and so on. So cognitive functioning is a similar process. I mean, it's not in science, it's formalized, you know, but just in ordinary life, you can approach something that way as well. You know, like you have to keep your antennas tuned. You know, that's a big part of it.
If you enjoyed that clip, then the full podcast is out right now. You can click around here. Enjoy. Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI.